is sponsored by the Oakland Press and Community Media Network. This is the second in our series of town hall meetings bringing you the issues of the day. And what is the issue of the day? Today, it's the Michigan film tax incentives. What's it all about? We're going to try to get your comments and your answers to these questions over here. Let me introduce to you a panel that knows what's going on over here. First of all, Tim Melton. He is a state representative from Pontiac. He's a Democrat. Next to him, Andy Meisner, the treasurer of Oakland County. And when he was in the legislature, he helped write the Michigan Film Tax Incentive. Sam Logan, next to him, he is a local filmmaker. A lot of list of credentials to his credit, which we won't go into right now, but just trust me, they're there. And State Representative Tom McMillin, Republican from Rochester Hills. Gentlemen, thank you for being on the program today. We'd also like to figure out what you want to know. So if you have a question, let us know. I want to start right now, real quick. Andy Meisner, when you were in the legislature, you helped write the Michigan Film Tax Incentives. What is this all about, and why is the governor trying to undo it right now, Andy?
Well, it wasn't just me, Charlie. You know, it was a very broad and bipartisan coalition of folks, kind of a rare coming together of Democrats and Republicans alike to address what continues to be the number one problem facing Michigan, which is jobs. And as a state, you know, we've had our eggs in the manufacturing basket for a long time. We've had a need to diversify the economy. We did a lot of research and we found out that the motion picture and digital media industry was one that we thought we would be able to bring to Michigan. And so we worked together along party lines and brought people together and came up with a very comprehensive package that made us number one in the country for motion pictures. And that's why we've created over 6,000 jobs. We've had almost $1 billion in investment. And according to the Ernst & Young study, we've got $6 return on every dollar, every taxpayer dollar that's been invested. So we've created jobs, we're diversifying the economy, we're fighting the brain drain, and to me, that's what it's all about.
All right, now I understand that there's a counter to that, but we'll get into that in a minute. Tim Melton, Democrat from Pontiac area, you have a film studio in your district in which a lot of money was invested, and the potential is there under the governor's plan, perhaps, that studio may be done. True?
Yeah. I on my way here, we drove by it. I wanted to make sure it was still open. there's been a lot of talks. You know, I was in the legislature with Treasurer Meisner when this was passed, and I think there's a couple things to note. Number one, before you can talk about, is this thing working? What was it designed to do? Number one was obviously create jobs and diversify the economy. I mean, Pontiac, Detroit, Saginaw, Flint, we've been that one trick pony for a long time, the automotive industry. How do we diversify? Everyone in the state talks about diversifying the economy. This is one way of truly diversifying the economy, and Pontiac is the perfect example. Not only do we have a film studio now, it's in an old GM facility. So this is the true definition of diversifying the economy. And Andy talks about the Ernst & Young study, the 6-to-1, but there was another component. How do we keep our young people here? You heard Governor Snyder during the last election cycle, and also the Democratic candidate talk about how do we keep our young people in the state of Michigan. This industry keeps young people in Michigan, and we've got story after story after story of people that were going to go to Chicago or LA or down south, and they're staying here in Michigan now. So define what do we want it to do, and is it working? And I hope we can get into that during this discussion tonight.
All right. Thank you, Tim. Sam Logan, let me go to you. You are a filmmaker. You, maybe more than anybody in this room, may be affected directly by this proposal if it goes away. Well, what's your take?
There's no doubt that I've benefited directly by way of the film incentive. There are certain jobs. I'm also a member of the Screen Actors Guild, so I work both as a producer, director, writer, and actor. And on an acting level, speaking on behalf of many of the union actors here in the state, speaking for them, these are opportunities, naturally, that they would never get a chance to embark in if the state didn't have the film incentive. There are story after story in the Oakland Press and the other news, local newspapers, about actors that we've seen sort of picked out and gone off and had pretty decent careers because they booked these roles. They were sort of the big fish in the small sea. Naturally, in Los Angeles or New York, if you don't have a giant, talent agent sort of behind your back, sort of pushing you forward, you're not going to get the opportunity for these parts. Equally, I think that could be said for the people working behind the scenes as union electricians, art department, grips, and of course, the ancillary businesses, the hotels, the craft service people. And these are all people that are actually benefiting by way of jobs. I think there's a second part to that, but I think we'll let...
All right, very good. You know what? We have three politicians and one filmmaker. If you didn't know, which would you guess would be the filmmaker? I don't know. Tom McMillin, it's not you. State representative right now. We've heard that this incentive program, it produces jobs, it perhaps keeps young people here. You may have a different take on this.
Well, yeah, I mean, as I said in an article in a major newspaper, that if you paid 42% of the salaries for, you know, clowns and acrobats, you'd have a circus on every corner. People, first of all, I think I've talked to legislators, they didn't realize this was actually a subsidy. They thought it was a tax credit. This is actually a 42% subsidy. It's costing jobs. You know, you're going to hear studies. There's one study, and I'm going to cite it. It's from the MEA, the Michigan Education Association. They commissioned a study from Anderson Economic
Group.
Read
that stuff, Tom?
Well, they have no dog in this fight. They just want to make sure that the money's spent well. So, you know, the other studies, you know, are done by the people that benefit from it. This one said that actually every time a movie comes here, it costs jobs in Michigan because these other studies, what's convenient is politicians love very visible winners and invisible losers. There are tons of businesses that that had to pay higher taxes, or the citizens did. If we would have just kept that money here instead of sending it to Hollywood, paying two-thirds of the salaries our actors, producers from outside the state, if we kept that money here, there'd be spin-off jobs, there'd be people going to hotels, there'd be even more. You would actually have saved more jobs if we just eliminate this program.
All right. I have a feeling we're going to have a dispute as to the statistics tonight. We want to know what you're thinking. If you're watching us, you can give us a call here at CMN at 248-589-7778, or you can log on to theoaklandpress.com. And this gentleman right over here, Steve Fry, who's been manning the phones and the emails, and I understand that we've got a couple right now, Steve.
Oh, yes, sir. We have quite a number of comments coming in. The first one is from Melissa Amara, and she asks, what companies does the governor have lined up to replace the film industry jobs that he's chasing away, feeling that eliminating this incentive will chase away jobs? And Michael Abbott says, I would rather they be given true tax credits, not cash back. Make them submit a statement on how much they actually spend here in Michigan with receipts, then give them a portion of that back in tax breaks, not with a check. That way no actual cash is coming out of our pockets.
Let me take the second one over here. I know that both Andy Meisner, Tim Melton, you raised the Ernst & Young study that said $6 comes back to the state of Michigan for every dollar that is spent in the film industry. Now, there's another study. It's by the Senate Fiscal Agency. I'm sure you're familiar with it. If you look at those numbers, according to that study said that only 17.5 cents would come back to the state of Michigan.
You know, if I may, Charlie, you know, that's an important point, and Representative Melton alluded to that. You know, you could say that the motion picture credit, you know, has not returned dollar for dollar to the Treasury, you know, what's come out. And what I would tell you to that is that the bill didn't cure cancer either. And what do those two things have in common? Neither of those were the intent. The intent was, here we were in 2007, 2008, really at the bottom of a horrible economic cycle, and we were looking for something that could be a game changer. And respectfully, the difference between the motion picture and digital media industry and clowns and circuses is that the motion picture and digital media industry is a multi-billion dollar industry, just video games alone. So one, they're much larger industries. Two, there were specific attributes that the state of Michigan had, like a very hardworking workforce that was ready to go, like scene locations like anyone imaginable. And so there was research that we did, and unlike the governor's current plan, which doesn't project the creation of one job, we were able to look and see what our friends in Louisiana, New Mexico, Connecticut, what they had done, and we were able to leapfrog them with hard number projections. But all these changing and the taxing of the pensions, there's not one job that's projected from that change.
But let me see if I understand it and just help me out. If I received 42% of my investment, I could hire, and I'll put it this way, if I hired 10 more lawyers in my law firm, and I would say, and then the state would say they're going to give me 42% of what I pay these lawyers, of course there's going to be jobs.
Well, the practical...
Everybody would have a job.
The practical rate is actually closer to 34 or 35%. And, you know, the fact is that when you're all manufacturing, what we need to do is replace those jobs. We have done that. In 2007, there were about $3 million in projects that were done in Michigan. By the time Governor Granholm signed my bill in April of 2008, we had $125 million in business lined up. You can't say that about clones, about clowns and circuses.
But Tim Melton, as, according to the numbers that I've researched here, that Michigan taxpayers spent $96 million of taxpayer money to underwrite the film costs. Is that a good use of money?
Charlie, let's say this. 44 states have film credits. There's been studies done in almost every state, and it's not deniable or undeniable that between $6 and $10, not of return to the Treasury, but economic activity. So I will tell you that there's $80 million of investment sitting in Pontiac right now. And that's why I drove by to make sure it's still open. $80 million of people that said, look, you made a commitment to us and a tax credit. We've built the studio. The key here is having the infrastructure in place in Michigan. If people fly in and fly back to California to do the editing and the backroom stuff, it probably doesn't pay for itself. But when you actually have the physical investment in Michigan and all the backroom stuff is done here, it does. It's over 3,000 jobs in Pontiac. I will tell you, Frank the dumpster guy, who actually has said, look, I've created a dumpster business because 16 films have used my dumpster business, and he's hiring people. The spin-off jobs that you don't even know exist are out there. The limo company that just expanded. You know, the Marriott, the Pontiac Marriott that is just jumping at the seams right now because people are coming to stay there because they're traveling here to do the film work here. So I'll say this. The studies speak for themselves. The number coming back to Treasury is a different number altogether. $6 of economic activity for every dollar spent.
Would you agree,
that's
though,
what you want.
Would you agree that more dollars have been given to non-Michigan residents than to Michigan residents?
Charlie, let's hold on. Let's go here.
Yeah, 60% of the spend has been on Michigan folks.
But,
majority.
But here's the point. But okay, we can debate back and forth.
Here's the study says 2-1 is out of state 2-1.
Here's the point.
Go ahead, Jim.
The Michigan Works Agency has now retrained workers to get into this industry. We've had over 2,000 people in Michigan that have went to OCC, Oakland University, to our film, to be in this industry, to stay in Michigan. So now the state has an investment that we've retrained people for this industry, and then we're gonna see them all leave the state. So now we're, you know, in a reverse investment mode. So I gotta say, we can argue about where they're coming from, but let's compromise. Let's look at a way. You wanna talk about where the investment is now and the credit is now. Let's, instead of eliminating it, let's get together and say, let's incentivize people that hire Michigan workers more. Maybe the rate needs to be changed a little bit.
If everything's going so well, you don't need to compromise. Well, let me just get Tom McMillin in here for a minute though. Tom, you really can't deny that this program created jobs. I mean, look at the numbers that we've talked about. I don't think anybody can argue that. Jobs are created because of this legislation.
Well, if you pay 42% of any business, you know, you're going to get jobs in here. It is breaking the bank. It's hurting us. It's costing us jobs. If that $200 million that Ernst & Young talks about, if that would have stayed in Michigan businesses, they would have created jobs. They would have had spin-off jobs. They would have actually created more jobs. Then, look,
What's wrong with that?
That's why we should have had them. We should have kept it here in Michigan. That's how you keep young people here, is to have jobs. These, every time a movie comes here, it costs jobs. George Clooney walks in, we cut a check to him for $840,000. So about 15 jobs gone, just because he walked in here and is in this state. So, you know, I mean, it makes nice headlines. It makes some politicians feel like they're good, but it actually costs jobs.
Okay, let's get a question from the audience here. What's your name?
Jeremy Elser from Rochester Hills. I understand, I'm hearing we should continue to spend good money after bad. We've already invested. We should continue investing. Why should the government be in the business of picking winners and losers?
You know, to this point, you know, we have got, you know, this talk about winners and losers. You know, right now, while there's no focus on jobs and focusing on beating up seniors on their pension and beating up schools with $700 per pupil decreases, this winners and losers, this is a false argument. The fact is that, you know, I was chairman of the Commerce Committee. And what I was trying to do was to try to find some industries where there were some assets that we had where we might have some competitive advantage. You know, for instance, advanced manufacturing. Michigan is and will continue to be a place where the whole world will look for engineering and research and development. That's a strength. So playing off of your strength, you know, that's what we're supposed to do. That's what other states are doing. And if we, you know, we wish that we could live in a world where, you know, incentives weren't required, that would be great. But, you know, my message to Representative McMillin is, if you're saying that you can apply this to other industries, then let's examine that as a matter of tax policy. Because to me it's worked. Let's see if it could work. You know, suggest, make a serious suggestion about some other industries that could bring this volume of business, because we need it. We need jobs.
See, and the problem is with central planning is the USSR found out it doesn't work. So he's there in Lansing trying to figure out how to diversify the economy by focusing on certain industries. Well, that, diversify and focus in the same sentence, that makes no sense. The best way to diversify the economy, keep the money with our current businesses and our current taxpayers and let them grow their jobs, you know, economic gardening, make sure that we take care of the current businesses.
Why can't we do both?
Well, because we're losing money. It doesn't make sense. If that money comes from somewhere, it comes from our current taxpayers. Our businesses have to lay off people or can't hire people because they are cutting checks for taxes to pay for these incentives, these subsidies.
All right, $2 billion tax cut that the governor's proposing is going to come from seniors' pensions
trying to come back,
and from education.
We're not talking about that.
It's true. The purpose of those cuts is to subsidize a business
that
doesn't have one job projection.
But it's scary to think.
Governor Snyder hasn't said one state that says, hey, we've gone to this model, and this is the number of jobs that have created. This is a scientific process here.
He's clueless on economics. It's unbelievable.
All right. If you'd like to join our conversation, getting lively now. The number to call is 248-589-7778, or you can log into theoaklandpress.com, where I understand Steve Fry of the Oakland Press has a few of those callers who wrote in some emails, right? Steve?
Oh, yeah. Well, they're not callers. They're typers or
tweeters. Typers.
No, here's one. This is from Resident 11. This law is the biggest waste of tax dollars possible. Nothing more than corporate welfare. And then VQ Videos, he writes, how about permanent jobs versus transient type, which is what occurs now? If they think Michigan is such a great place to make movies or other film projects, then put some permanent jobs in place first, then the credits will come. The credits should be an incentive to do more, not just a little thanks for coming to Michigan handout while they're on their way back to California or New York, never to come back unless they get more credits to do something.
Exactly. That's the issue. I mean, if you could pick any industry to give a tax credit, you would. This is the last industry because by their nature, they are transient. They're going to go to the next state. You can't pull back. It's such a joke to say we could pull back these credits someday. We never will. London just pulled theirs back. Everybody left. Every state, Mitch Albom said if you reduce it 1%, the others will start coming, so going somewhere else, and now he wants to reduce it a few percent. But
Sam, are you transient?
Well, I'm from Michigan, so naturally, I don't think I'll really ever move. I love it here. Not to say that I won't go on vacation. I think we all need to get away from the snow sometimes. But one thing to be said about the Film Incentive Program, I think some of the gripes that I hear from friends of mine are that. You know, we're in the pharmaceutical industry. How come we're not getting 42% back? Or we're in the, you know, basket weaving industry. I don't know. How come we're not getting 42% back? Or new technologies, energy.
Sam, do you have any stats on how many jobs, though, are actually created, people that actually stay in Michigan? Even the numbers that I've got, though, and I think it is said, though, that even the Ernst & Young study, though, did say that most of the money does go to people from out of state.
Right. I'm going to be sitting in between these guys. I think I'm going to be slightly careful about when, you know, I've
the rose between the thorns. I understand.
I've gotten a lot of different numbers, naturally, depending on how you count it. But something, again, a couple of things I would just want to note that I've been sort of sitting on is that Representative Melton here had noted is economic activity. So not necessarily something that's going directly back to the Treasury, but is there my concern is there an intangible benefit? in the film incentive program. Because unlike the pharmaceutical industry or new technologies, you know, there was a video that was made, I think, I'm going to say, by Nancy Skinner, who recently interviewed Mitch Albom. And he said something, to paraphrase Mitch, I think, and he said something very interesting is, if you go anywhere in the world, ask people what Paris looks like, ask people what New York looks like, ask people what LA looks like, and then ask them to draw you freehand a picture of Detroit or Traverse City or Saginaw. They're not going to be able to do that. So one of the things that is a cause for achieving or getting the incentive, actually getting approved for the incentive, is do you benefit the state by way of tourism through the project itself? Is it going to make the state look good? Is it going to make it look like a place that I want to know where that movie was made? Let's go there. You know.
Gran Torino. All right, and speaking of Nancy Skinner, we happen to have Nancy Skinner right here in our audience today. Let me just go right here. Okay, Nancy, you have a question.
Well, first of all, Tom, I did go to the University of Michigan and have a business degree from there, so I hope you don't consider me clueless in economics. But I did interview Mitch, and here was his point, larger point, that the credits had to start out to be high to attract the industry here so that the infrastructure could be here, so it wasn't transient. But now we're opening studios in Tim's district and Raleigh, and post-production is happening, and people are being trained. So what we did is started capturing. So I think on the economics front, I think the Ernst & Young study actually understates. My two websites that we started, filmcreditswork.com and Tell Rick, we've collected now we have 12,000 supporters. These are over 6,000 email stories of people that you would never conceive of who reinvented themselves, laid off auto workers, single mothers, who went back to film school, and after our devastating 10-year recession, found work on a promise that they would have this. Now the rug is going to be pulled out from underneath them.
Let me ask you something. Uh-huh. Now, Nancy, you have a business degree from the University of Michigan, a very prestigious school. Let's assume just for the moment that instead of the film industry, the 42% tax breaks will be given back to an auto industry like Chrysler, General Motors. Do you know how many of those you'd have? You'd have 60,000, maybe 600,000. My point is that if the state gives money, correct me if I'm wrong, if the state gives money, you're going to create jobs and you're going to get people that don't like it when the money goes.
I'll specifically answer that question, Charlie, because one, we did give our auto industry a heck of a bailout, and I was on national TV fighting for it, and it has been good, but we shed hundreds of thousands of jobs because the maturity, we needed diversification. This industry, as Andy and them have pointed out, is never going away. Entertainment, digital arts, the sophistication that goes along with this, the training, the infrastructure that is now, so we can, and Mitch wants to look at amending this to keep more of the production here in Michigan now that we can do something like that. But to, I think, to Sam's point here, what we've seen, we created a website, filmcreditswork.com, these stories of people who are moving back to Michigan. I've got thousands of people from LA, they want to come back here, start their careers, mothers who are seeing their kids come back. What is the value? Pure Michigan, we all agree, was a great ad campaign, right? What is the value of rebranding this terrible image of Detroit across the country? Detroit 187, we had to cover this. I'm doing live webcasts now on my show, Film Credits Work, of losing Detroit 187 because they can't get credit on a national television program. The benefits are so, the hope, the money, the jobs, the diversification. If the governor can't come to some agreement with the legislators about how we keep this industry, it will be a travesty for our country.
Thank you, Nancy. We only have an hour, though, but you're good. Okay.
Charlie, speaking of the governor. Now,
Andy.
I'm assuming that the governor did not propose $25 million for this program because he thinks it's a waste of money. And there might be a little bit of space between Representative McMillin and Governor Snyder. Now, I take the governor at his word when he says that the reason he proposed $25 million for this industry that he didn't propose for a lot of other industries is because he sees the value and sees the economic impact. And so that's why I do hope that there is some room for negotiation and compromise, and that's the indication that I get. The governor's not saying it's terrible, it isn't working. He's saying that we're in tight budget times and that we want to, you know, maybe try to rein in the cost, which is something that I can absolutely support. And I really do sympathize with Representative McMillin and Representative Melton because they've got a horrible budget crisis that they're trying to deal. And I really do wish them the best with that.
Join the conversation on the phone, 248-589-7778, or you can log in to theoaklandpress.com. We have a caller right now on the line. Your question, please, caller.
Yeah, I had a question would be, let's have a comment from the panelists regarding what happened with Unity Studios or what didn't happen with Unity Studios, and how do we avoid companies coming in with those kinds of promises down the road and not having them come to fruition?
That's a great question.
Go ahead, Sam.
Oh, I'm sorry.
That's a great question. I mean, here, Alan Park, you know, here again, a very visible winners. This investment company and these guys come in, we're going to do all kinds of this great stuff. Well, now they're laying off all their firefighters because it was such a debacle. Grand Rapids, there was a scam also that tried to bilk us of $10 million. Look, these studios, taxpayers are paying $20 million of Tim's $80 million, and our kids are going to pay the majority of the rest because it was stimulus money. So these people are not investing because they think it's a good investment without all this kind of tax money. Plus, if it goes belly up, they've got a warehouse, and taxpayers paid for most of it.
Sam.
Well, you know, I was going to say part of my own gripe as someone from Michigan and watching this happen in front of me is that unfortunately the film business is a smoke and mirrors industry, both on camera and behind camera, and it carries a lot of sex appeal. And one of the things that I would like to see from my own politicians is coming down a little bit harder with a clear distinction of the caliber of what projects, both by way of infrastructure or by way of an actual film being made itself, is worth that incentive. Because as we've seen, it's sort of like highway robbery. Mm-hmm. When someone says, oh, I want to build a studio here, give me money. Grand Rapids, Allen Park, I'm totally behind you on that, because I've got family in Allen Park across the street from that studio who saw all that kind of go down the drain. And I sat there going, I mean, I can smell this. I'm in the film industry, I can smell this. I'm from Michigan and I can smell this. How come my politicians can't?
Is the caller still there? Okay. Thank you, Sam. Question from the audience.
Yes, my name is Yasmin. I'm from Detroit. I'm part of a group of filmmakers called the Aurora Filmmakers Group. Thank you all for being here. I have two questions. The first one is for Representative McMillin. Are you against incentives in general and the way this particular law is set up, or are you against the fact that the target, that the beneficiary of the incentives is the film industry? And if your answer to the second question, if your answer is no, you're not against the beneficiary being the film industry, is there some way you would change the incentive so that there'd be some other way in which it sounds like you're concerned about the balance of the benefit being in Michigan? Is there some way that you could alter the law so that the net effect would benefit Michigan residents? And the second question
We'll get you.
No, I oppose corporate welfare straight across and picking winners and losers. So I particularly am opposed to this one because it actually costs jobs every time a movie comes to Michigan. So, I mean, by its nature, the whole idea of very visible winners and invisible losers. So, no, I'm opposed. There's no other, anybody else making things, they'd love to have 20% if you want to cut it to 20 or 15. Why are we doing it for an industry that's by its nature transient? We'll never stay here.
All right, on that note, we'll take a quick break. Didn't want to leave that thought, but we will get back when we come back. Again, this is the Town Hall Meeting, sponsored by the Oakland Press and Community Media Network. Join the conversation by giving us a call at 248-589-7778 or log in to theoaklandpress.com. We'll take a quick break. Back in a moment.
Nervous. They never hosted before. They've never been in front of the camera before.
And it's not something people get to do every day. They want to present themselves in the best light.
Michigan Actors Studio is the premier acting school in the state of Michigan.
This workshop is helping people to do that, to really learn how to answer questions in a way that's really effective, how to present on camera, and even somebody who doesn't want to be a professional actor, there's a lot there for people.
Michigan Town Hall. Today, the topic is the Michigan tax incentives. I'm Charlie Langton. Thanks for joining us here. If you'd like to get in our conversation, the number to call is 248-589-7778, or you can log in to theoaklandpress.com, and we'll get your question for our panelists here. Again, Tim Melton, Andy Meisner, Sam Logan, and Tim McMillin. And we're going to start right now. You have another question for one of our panelists.
Yes, this one is actually for the proponents of the law, Representative Melton and Oakland County Treasurer Andy Meisner. I wonder, and actually for the other panelists too, I wonder, is there a period over which the incentives would phase out? That is, do we imagine a time in which we would not need to lure companies to Michigan with incentives when we're for lack of a better word, confident enough with the skills and talents of our own native industry to say, okay, you all should like us on our merits? Or is that even reasonable? I know that 43 other states have incentives, so I don't know.
I think that is a good question. Mitch Albom with this Amend It, Don't End It coalition and Michigan Film First, and there's a couple different groups out there, you know, that have put forth a proposal, that would scale this back significantly. You know, for instance, when we did the legislation in 08, we didn't have that many people in the industry that were working in the state. And so that's why we did 40% or 42% for the productions and then 30% for out of state. Now that we're 3 years in and we've had a chance to train thousands of Michigan workers, I personally think that we should take the out of state component down to zero. And I think that over the next 3-5 years, that you could see a phase down and then eventually a phase out once we have the infrastructure in Representative Melton's district, we have trained folks, and we're on the map as a place where people can come and get well-trained workers. They can get the beautiful diversity of scene locations that they can't get in New Mexico. Guess what? We got the Great Lakes, we've got inland rivers and streams, we've got big cities, we've got suburbs, inner ring suburbs, and the whole like. And so I do think, and I would hope that we could work with our friends on both sides of the aisle, to talk about a phase out, scaling it down, and then eventually out.
Tom, we do have beautiful scenery here in Michigan.
Yeah, we do.
Don't we?
We do, but there's,
even Republicans agree with that, don't they?
The big proponent, Mitch Albom, he said last year when we were looking at just taking it down a few percent, if you take it down 1%, they're all going to leave because then they know that we'll reduce it. Well, now he's wanting to amend it and reduce it a little bit. They are going to leave the minute that we get rid of it. London just got rid of their film credits. All of them are going. They're saying that they're coming here because of the film credits. They're going to go. It's a transient industry. Look,
Tom,
it's sexy. Boy, it makes headlines.
Tom, we had a committee. Detroit News reported just last week that a project, $58.2 million was to be spent here in Michigan that would have created 2,250 jobs, and apparently they're gone.
Well, like I said, actually, the tax that we would have had to raise in order to pay for that 42%, people would have had to lay off more people than what would have been produced. It costs money. Every time a movie comes to Michigan, it costs us jobs, net jobs.
Where do these jobs disappear to? 3 years. I guess, Charlie, my point is, we're 3 years into this. We're still in the infancy stage. If GM wanted to build a brand new factory in Michigan, it's going to take 2.5 to 3 years to actually build it, from planning to the design to getting all the presses in here. And let me tell you what, 44 other states have a film industry and a credit. They're not going away. So if we want to be a player, if we want to be a player in this industry, we're going to have to do some incentive. Michigan wasn't the natural place to be for film industry. So we had to create some incentive up front to get them here. Now they're here. Let's have a discussion about a phase out. Don't go, we're going to eliminate it or go to 25 and then phase it down to 5 and then get rid of it. Let's talk about something that's realistic and how we use $80 million in Pontiac. I will tell you, all of the businesses around there are now looking at how do we capitalize and how do we grow our industry. And I will tell you this, the movie industry is almost recession-proof. The video game industry is recession-proof. It doesn't go up and down. Even in economic poor times, the movie industry actually does better in some cases.
And Republican Governor John Kasich in Ohio, Republican Governor Bobby Jindal, in New Mexico, these two Republican governors are thrilled with what's going on in Michigan right now because all the projects, some of them are leaving and going to their state where this program has their enthusiastic support.
Tom McMillin, you've got a lot of fans in the audience. They want you to explain how you lose a job when apparently all these jobs
are paying. $200 million came out of businesses' pockets. You think that, you know, there are very visible winners that are creating some jobs, but there are businesses that had to lay off people or not hire people. That $200 million, if it would have stayed in Michigan, would have created jobs, would have created spin-off.
You said it's coming from the state coffers.
The $4.50 of that Ernst & Young are spin-off jobs. You can't count that.
But you said that the money's coming out of the
cost.
If the money's coming out of the treasury, then it would have to be the state government that's hiring those jobs.
No, that money doesn't.
And are you suggesting that we have an expansion of state government?
The money doesn't show up at the treasury by itself.
You said it comes
out of our pockets and out of businesses' pockets.
But respectfully, Representative, I think I heard you say that your concern is that this tax credit is taking money out of the state coffers. And you said $200 million.
Out of our pockets as well.
And so if the money was returned, it wouldn't go to the businesses, it would go to the state coffers. And you said that it would be for job creation.
This is actually
as a Republican, you're saying put the money back in the state coffers.
That's what the NEA wants.
And then let the state government hire and have an expansion of state government?
Well, or less lower the taxes.
To be the Democrat who's saying
lower the taxes.
Listen, I don't want Lansing to have anything to do with this.
Lower the taxes.
My point is this.
I can't believe people actually think paying 42% of anything, all of the expenses, not a tax credit on their tax return, but actually cutting $100 million or $200 million
a check.
I can't believe anybody thinks that's good.
Obviously, that would work. Obviously, Tom, 145 senators and reps thought it was good because this bill passed 145-1. So there was one person in the legislature. So we did the study. It went through a committee in the House.
They thought it was something else.
It went through the committee.
They thought it was not refundable.
Tom,
People did not realize it went through the committee.
We had hearings. It passed in the committee. Went to the House floor. It passed. Went to the Senate. It had committee hearings. The governor supported 145-1. So it's not just the Republican governors in Ohio and Louisiana. It passed 145-1.
As the filmmaker in the center, can I just ask a question for someone who might be thinking it but not wanting to ask it? I think the Michigan Film Office numbers are $116 million paid out so far as of March of this year.
No, the Ernst & Young said $200 million.
Film Office is $116 and I think $244 left. And so to benefit these people, where else, I guess, would that $116 million be invested if not paid out to get...
Well, Tom would argue that they could lower the taxes.
We could either cut
that.
The tax
lower
rate
the
a little bit.
As a matter of fact, I saw a debate that they were almost going to do that, but we would have had to cut the tax credit. Let me get a question from the audience. If you're on, by the way, the number to call here is 248-589-7778, or you can log into theoaklandpress.com, and we'll get you an email, and we'll read that on the air here. But we have a question from the audience. Finally.
Hi. I understand how you want to keep the incentives for Michigan jobs here and how you say that that keeps you from being able to give business breaks to companies already here. But that mom-pa little place that has a diner or somebody like that, you're not going to bring them anything unless you bring them a massive job thing. And I don't see where 50% of something is higher, greater than 0% or 100% of nothing. Also, just one other thing, and I agree with Sam. From the time this country was settled and people moved west, they went through Chicago, St. Louis, Louisville. Michigan has never been a go-through state. It's a go-to state. Nobody knows us, which is bad, but it's also good. We have a chance to reinvent ourselves. These people that come here and they're here a couple weeks, they're going to be in a hotel a month more. They'll rent a house, buy a house. Hey, can you come out? We're going to Catalina this weekend. No, why don't you come to Detroit? Detroit, what's going on? There's an ethnic festival or a church carnival. Or state fair, hint, hint. They don't have those there.
How much do we spend on pure Michigan? Thank you for
the question. They just did $10 million last month. They did a $10 million investment that the legislature and the governor supported.
Right.
And they said that the reason they supported it is because there was a $3 return on every dollar invested in pure Michigan. So that was after they said that they weren't going to consider multiplier effects.
So
one, we like it.
Two, the film is doing double what Pure Michigan's doing.
It's totally not, because that was $3 tax dollars for every dollar. Actually, the film credits create about $10 for every $100 we spend. We lose $90. So it's totally different. It's the Pure Michigan, they claimed it brought in $3 tax dollars. Those people pay us 10 bucks. We pay them a $100 check.
But the governor is still, the film industry is not, he's going to honor the $75 million in commitments from years past, and he's going to still allow $25 million this year and $25 million next year for film incentives. That's 2.5 times Pure Michigan. Well, doesn't that help?
Charlie,
isn't that good?
Charlie, first off, the governor doesn't allow anything. The governor
proposes. You guys do it.
And
you guys
do it. We have to make some decisions about what we're going to fund. And you know, George Will, the columnist, says capital goes where it is welcome and it stays where it is well treated. And capital follows that model. I mean, you can't just say the tax rate is the only decision that companies make. Apple's in Cupertino, California. Microsoft's in the West. You got New York. You got Boston, the Research Triangle. Capital and businesses just don't go because of the tax rate. It's also quality of life. And I will tell you, being on film shoots, when you hear the buzz around it, people start feeling good about being in Michigan. Sam talks about that intangible. Yeah, you can't put a dollar amount on it, but you know what? There's a pride that's restored in Michigan. It used to be because we made autos. And in Pontiac, we had 27,000 blue-collar jobs in Pontiac. We're down to like 600. But now, the excitement about the 3,000 jobs being created at that movie studio, the people going to college to take those jobs, there's excitement that I want to stay here because of it. And there are spinoffs. I'm going to tell you, the local, the guy that used to get all his business from truck and bus at the Coney Island, he is tickled to death because all of a sudden he's seeing business again. The gas stations, the restaurants, all kinds of businesses flourishing.
One more
dry
question.
Cleaning.
Go ahead.
I just comment. Sam was saying if we had basket weavers that we brought in here and gave them an incentive, the most you could get from that was when those basket weavers would have their family in here for Thanksgiving dinner.
Right.
The media industry, you get a lot of people. Yeah. We can be noticed. We're going to be noticed one way or the other. And there's not a better person to either make a fool of yourself in front of or shine than the filmmaking industry.
That's true. Charlie Sheen proved that. All right, let me get over here. Another question over here. And here. Okay, you have a question.
Yes, sir. My name is Brock Little. I'm a local actor. And in fact, I was cast in one of Sam Logan's films.
That's why it was good, let me tell you.
Absolutely. I just spent 3 weeks on a film where and regularly I'm a substitute teacher. Now I just spent 3 weeks on a film, and during that 3 weeks, the film industry pays pretty well. In that 3 weeks that I spent on that film, I probably made about $1,000 more in that 3 weeks than I would have made as a substitute teacher. Now, is this one of those intangibles that you're talking about?
I think that's to Tom McMillin, right?
Yeah. No, well, they're talking about intangibles, and that it took a little longer than I thought, but typically this argument goes to intangibles because the numbers don't make any sense for it. So you got to start talking about what makes people feel good. What would make people feel good is if they had jobs, and this is a job killer. This costs jobs. So I think if we just stopped this, we lowered the tax rate, or we kept the money here in Michigan, instead of sending two-thirds of it out of the state, that's what would actually make people happier.
Can I just ask, what state do you look to where they've done something similar, and what were the jobs numbers so that it's not just a leap of faith? Because you seem genuinely interested in this. What state are you looking to as
a
guy?
If we would have kept, if we kept the $200 million here, you don't think that there would have been investment? People would have hired people?
But that's faith-based economics. And what I'm looking for is number projections.
See,
and it's a fair question.
Visible winners and invisible losers.
I'm
the opportunity cost, if you knew anything about economics, you would know that the opportunity cost of that $200 million is all the other businesses and families in Michigan would have that $200 million. They'd spend it. There'd be spin-off jobs. They'd
that's
be hiring people, $200 million. You can hire a lot of people with $200 million, a lot more than a few thousand.
But are there treasury,
any, though? But are there any
treasury? No. But are there any? I'm saying that if we wouldn't have had to tax those people, the citizens, the businesses.
But are there any tax structures in other states that you like that are think are working? And I'm asking that genuinely.
I'm just telling you that on its face,
you don't
want to
answer that.
Sense.
Which means that you haven't looked at any other states.
I've looked at all the other states.
We knew what you were going to get.
Studies. Look, I don't have two relatives in the industry like you do in the film industry. I understand that. But, you know, this is just a bad deal for Michigan. It makes no sense.
It's good for jobs for everybody. There's nothing
jobs
wrong with
in
that.
Michigan.
Name a state that's got tax policy that you would try to model us after.
Well, I mean, you reduce the tax rate, we'll have a lot more jobs.
Name
here.
A state, man. You're a state rep.
Louisiana does have a film incentive that appears to be working, and I think you just got done saying that the people are leaving Michigan and going to Louisiana.
Trying to get us out of the film business, and the suggestion that Representative McMillin has made and that the governor has made is that if we eliminate all the incentives, which I don't think is a terrible idea, I think they should all be scrutinized and reviewed, and I think there's great value for us to have such a robust debate about it, for Tom to be able to say what he thinks and for the state to be able to think what they think, but we need to be able to model. What is this based on?
Let Tim Melton get into this robust debate.
We have billions of dollars in tax incentives that are given out. Pieces of our tax code that are set asides. 1979, we put together a double exemption for oil and gas. But the problem that Andy's bringing up is we never said, what is that supposed to do? And we don't evaluate it every year or every other year. What is the first thing I said tonight is, what was the intent of the film credit? Was it to create jobs, keep young people here, and hopefully create investment? If that's how we're going to judge it, then is it working or not? 145 people voted for it, and the governor signed it based on that premise. And that premise means it's working.
248-589-7778 is the number to join us, or you can log on to theoaklandpress.com. Steve Fry of the Oakland Press has some comments as he's been sifting through the multiple emails that we've been getting. Steve.
Yes, this is from Cheryl Lynn. Yes, we should keep the film incentives. The film industry brought jobs to Michigan that our own state couldn't produce for us. So what if it costs money to keep them here? Sometimes you just have to spend money to make money. And this comes from Lion Lenny. Lion, L-I-O-N. Lenny. Can it become a sustainable industry once we modify the incentives? And he believes that the peripheral economic activity from the film should not be dismissed. And finally, from EJB Design. But how much money is the film industry bringing into the economy? If it's more than $96 million or the $100 million that's paid out, then she said, yes, it's worth it. So how much money has come in?
$6 for every dollar is the economic activity.
It's almost a billion dollar investment.
Wait a minute. Every Ernst & Young and every CPA firm, you're a CPA, Tom.
Ernst & Young has made this a cottage industry. They've done this for almost all states. Tom. And the Federal Reserve Director in the Northeast just slammed all of the Ernst & Young studies. And she had no dog in this fight either. These studies are, it's a cottage industry. No other CPA firm would have the audacity and ridiculousness to do this.
The Senate fiscal study that said 17.5 cents
for every dollar.
That's treasury.
I'm talking about economic activity that's not being measured by that. So there is, in every state that's done a study, it's between $6 and $10 of economic activity. So the question was, the $96 million, how much has been put back? Well, there's an $80 million film studio in Pontiac that paid all those wages for all that investment and all those people that built that and worked on it. And let me tell you what, that film studio gets no credit for the full-time jobs that are there. The ones that are going to be there as the film industries leave and come in, there's no credit for those folks. Those are full-time jobs paying a city income tax, paying a state income tax, and utilizing all the businesses and services in our community. Those are real jobs. They don't get an incentive. The average job is $56,000 a year. Those are real wages with benefits and pensions. Those are real tax-paying jobs.
Charlie, if the 200 million stayed in businesses here in Michigan, they would have created many more than three or four or five times that amount. They have money to invest. They have spin-off. It's Keynesian economics. I don't know. It's bad. But at any rate, I mean, it's a loser.
Well, real people and real stories. They're invisible winners.
Right. They're invisible losers.
All right, a question from the audience. Go ahead.
My name is Shannon LaMarche. I am a producer and managing partner of QOA Entertainment. I live in your district, Representative McMillin. I just wanted to kind of piggyback off of something that Representative Melton said about the infrastructure being here now. It's coming here. If you build it, they will come. We had to have a larger incentive to attract them here. Michigan is very cold in the winter. We have no indoor facilities to speak of, we do now. We can attract the TV shows that will stay here, Detroit 187, if they choose to stay. And those create jobs over and over and over again. I'm not a Hollywood fat cat. You're not paying me 42% of my budgets, my film budgets, to leave the state. My film budgets are being spent here in Michigan, and that money's being recycled over and over again. So you can't tell me that the auto industry hasn't gotten millions upon millions of incentives to build plants here. Why do you think Mercedes went to Alabama and South Carolina?
Right to work.
And they had gotten incentives to go there.
Not
I mean,
bi-
this happens all the no. time. You're attracting business by offering incentives. Yeah, we can reduce the incentives and people will still stay here, but we had to get them here to begin with. I venture to guess that a lot of this cottage industry, as you call it, we're grassroots. We're developing a lot of production companies here that are Michigan-based.
All right, Tom, you're just against all incentives all the time.
Well, this one is the most egregious, though, and that the MEA study showed that it is the worst of all of them we have here in Michigan.
One more question from the audience. Time is going. Yes,
I have a very little concern for Tom. It's a little disrespectful to call film industry as a clown or circus group of people. They are quite respectable people and they are contributing to the economy. Film industry is a labor-intensive economy. Not only that, it provides immediate jobs, whereas the industries you are mentioning, you use the word would have. When will they create jobs, we do not know. So I feel that we are a little off the track. And let's not whip the galloping horse. They're providing good jobs. They're doing good business. Let's keep them as it is.
Well, yeah, and Charlie, I'm glad you brought that up because I obviously am not comparing clowns to actors. I'm saying any industry, even circus, chicken dinners, you pay 42% of them, you'll get a ton of chicken dinner companies here. I mean, any industry, that's just an extreme example. Of course, I'm not comparing the two. But, I mean, it's all about opportunity cost. We'd have a lot more jobs here if we didn't send those out, all those checks, hundreds of millions out to California.
If I might say something about Rally Studios, which happens to be one of the most prestigious studios by way of name recognition, I was a little disappointed with a lot of the, you know, what we had heard happen in Grand Rapids, Allen Park, but I'm very proud of what's happening with Rally. I think that in order for a studio like that to maintain itself, we're going to have to allot some sort of timetable and time to say, listen, this has to be slow. It can't be,
And one of the partners on that is Rahm Emanuel's brother. They got a ton of money from Washington. Our kids and grandkids are going to have to pay for it. That's
and
the
Disney
problem.
And Disney just moved in there, by the way, bringing hundreds of jobs.
All right, another question from the audience here.
One car accident, bring the whole car industry.
Go ahead.
Tom, I just had to make the statement that you're incredibly out of touch. We're talking about thousands of people, thousands and thousands of people that have benefited from this incentive. I, myself, I've started two different companies, as well as hundreds of other people have started companies in the state of Michigan that are benefiting from this for their families. What other companies and what other jobs are you talking to? You've sat there and just been a skipping record. You've said the same thing since you sat down. What? Be specific. You're a politician. Be specific on the people that you're talking about. What jobs were lost? Be specific. There's 44 other states that have an incentive for a reason, because it works. And you keep mentioning Mitch Albom. You have to understand, when Mitch said, if we lower this 1%, people are going to leave. Mitch doesn't represent the entire film community. He has our best interest in mind, but the fact is that we started this at the number that it was so that we could bring people into the state, because it was difficult to convince people to come to the state of Michigan. So that number, 40 or 42%, is what allowed me and thousands of other people, put that number in your head, thousands and soon to be, would be thousands more, to come to the state of Michigan. Now we've established an infrastructure. There's filmmakers out there that came here to make movies that said they hired 10 or 15 people opposed to the 90 out of state. That is now completely flipped over. The majority, sir, of the people that work on a film set, which I've been on many and I know you have never been on one, are Michigan people. Michigan residents that didn't have a job that now have a job. People from caterers, people that are doing dry cleaning, cleaning services, all the camera people, all the actors, not all the actors, excuse me, but most of the people on the set are from the state of Michigan. Those are people that came back to come back to their friends and family, people that moved here that have never been here, from here before. And Pure Michigan's a great ad campaign.
What specific do you want, Tom? Because we only have a couple minutes left. One specific question for Tom.
Give us an example of what you're talking about. We don't want the gray area. What jobs are being lost? Like how is this not benefiting the thousands of people working?
Like I said, Charlie, look, politicians and people love visible winners and invisible losers. They love to not think about the cost. There's $200 million that we paid, most of it out of state salaries.
Answer the question.
And those came from somewhere. $200 million is a lot of jobs, a lot more jobs.
But what jobs? They want to know about the jobs.
Well, I can't tell you that Joe lost his job. I can tell you $200 million would have had more. They would have had a lot more jobs if we had $200 million in this industry. I mean, in the state, if we had $200 million.
Let's
very visible winners.
Let's keep it respectful, gang. Gang, let's keep it respectful. You know, I appreciate Representative McMillin being here. It's courageous of him to do it. He's come to express a view.
Well, you know, it's audacious.
You look like a hostile crowd.
42%. I can't believe anybody would want it. Would say that they deserve it.
All right, we're gonna end it real quick. We're gonna just go down the line and make a final comment real quick. Sam, Logan, start.
Well,
please.
I think it is very important to identify the film industry as something that actually is intangible. So when we have conversations about it, we need to recognize what it's actually doing for the state by way of putting Michigan out there to the world. If we can keep that as a goal and identify what specifically are our goals. You talked about our goals, keeping young people here. And of course, yours is creating jobs. There's a disconnect between these two, but if we can respect each other and identify mutual goals, then I think the film incentive will actually work in a slightly different way to carry over from what's going on this side, carrying over what's going on this side, to benefit what's going on in this room and outside. Naturally, I'm a filmmaker. I want to make movies here. I'm going to make movies here no matter what. That's my promise. So,
Tim Melton,
it is please. It is creating jobs. When I look at my district, that's been some of the hardest hit areas in the entire state with the lost manufacturing jobs. We're now in a GM facility creating over 3,000 jobs. We've got to give it time to work.
Andy Meisner.
Jobs matter. All of our jobs need to be focused on creating jobs. That has not changed. This has done it. It's diversifying the economy, and it's actually fighting the brain drain, things that we've been talking about. It. We should replicate it and study it, not end it.
Thank you. Tom McMillin, the final comment.
The MEA probably despises me in most things, but I'm citing their study because it's the right one that actually this is the only study that took into account the opportunity cost. What could have happened with that $200 million? And it would have created more jobs. This is a net loser, and it costs jobs every time a movie comes here to Michigan. And it's just, if we want jobs, then we're going to have to eliminate this. And I feel very bad for the people that were sold something. They didn't realize, the politicians, the elected officials didn't realize this is actually a rebate, a subsidy. And it's just a bad deal for Michigan.
Tom McMillin, Sam Logan, Andy Meisner, and Tim Melton, I thank you very much. This issue is not done. We didn't solve all the world's problems today, but thank you for joining us here on this Town Hall Live meeting. I'm Charlie Lighton. We'll see you again on another Town Hall meeting sponsored by the Oakland Press and Community Media Network. Bye-bye now.